What a wild twist from a refugee camp. Listen to your song. Now we're hanging out with your house while you got the project, the Vanilla Ice project. That background noise is right behind us in a winter of Florida, which is very freezing. Obviously, it's cold weather.
Oh yeah,
terrible.
So cold.
Yeah, it's challenging.
Got my jacket on for this, you know.
So, brother, it's good to be here with you at your house.
Thank you. You're welcome.
You got one of the coolest stories with a lot of lessons in it that a lot of people can learn from, and it's inspirational story that you got that I want to kind of get into it. So we start.
You bet. Not a problem.
Before I go to that, when I was in the Army, it's 97. I went to a club in South Carolina.
Wow.
We went to a club in South Carolina. They're playing Ice Ice Baby. I'm in Nashville, Tennessee. We go to a club called Mix Factory, Ice Ice Baby. I went to a country club in Nashville. It's called Silverado. They're playing Ice Ice Baby.
Nice.
I mean, this is like Ice Ice Baby is played.
Line dancing.
All over the place. So what happened? How did this thing go from, you know, here's a kid, you're going back and forth from Dallas, Miami, your family, mom and dad, and then you write a song at 16, and then tell us the story about how this thing whole came about to Ice Ice Baby.
Basically, I had a fake ID. I was in Dallas. It was my brother's. He's 5 years older, so I took his driver's license. He could never find it, and that was my fake ID. So I would take that, and I would get it in clubs and stuff, and I went to this club over on Martin Luther King Boulevard called City Lights. I went in there, and they're having a talent contest. I had no idea. And my buddy says, man, you should get in there and do that, because I come from breakdancing era. I grew up to like Parliament, Funkadelic, Rick James, Zapp, Roger Troutman.
What were some of the movies, right?
Beat Street, Breakin', Turbo, yep. Ozone, yep. The whole wave, yep. And everything. And I had the mirror. But I had a breakdance crew, so I was 14 years old. And I would go to the mall and I would spin on my head and I'd make 40 bucks a day, chase the girls around the mall, eat some pizza, have some change left over. And that was more than all the rich kids could get from across the town, you know?
Wow.
And I loved doing it. So we would go out every day, big ghetto blaster, piece of cardboard right at the most busy door where people coming in and out. And it was the greatest thing ever. Got really good at it just by having fun. And then we had underage keg drinking parties. And all the high schools would come together and we would, you know, keg parties, and we would battle each other from other schools, like rap, beatboxing, and breakdancing.
This is here or this is Dallas?
This is Dallas, Texas.
Got it.
And I was at R.L. Turner High School. And in Farmers Branch, not Carrollton.
Farmers Branch.
Thought I was from Carrollton because that's more where the richer people live. And what a blast I had at that school. So we would go to Prestonwood Mall, which doesn't exist anymore. The Galleria does. We would, you know, but it was even before that. It was the most amazing breakdance movement ever. And that's what influenced me. And that's why when it was time for me to sit down and write music, that's what influenced me, so that's what was going to come out. So I was heavily into poetry even before the music, which is kind of everything kind of tied together and then drove me in that direction.
How did that happen? How did poetry happen with you?
Poetry came and I was horrible in English and horrible in school in English, but somehow I just related to poetry more than anything on the planet. Even to this day, everything is poetry with me. Like, I can give you thousands of dollars worth of therapy by just saying a few little phrases that'll change your whole mindset. Like, yesterday's history, tomorrow's a mystery. That's so, you know, I don't have to sit down and tell you everything about it. Just think about it a little bit. Or we are who we are because of who we were. Or just all this comes from poetry, you know, from Edgar Allan Poe to all the different poets throughout life. I always just gravitate.
Even as a kid, you were gravitating
towards poetry. Poetry, always.
So is that what led to writing the song, or how did that happen?
It led to definitely to writing the song and make me who I am, you know, because I wanted to express myself. And then the influence of the hip-hop culture movement had that influence in me, and then the poetry, and it was only natural that I write and do what I did, you know? I didn't know any other way of doing it, you know?
Who had the most influence at that time with the hip-hop culture? Because 1990, who's around in 1990? This is pre-Dre, Tupac, this is pre those guys,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, I was at that club, City Lights, and my buddy says, man, get up on stage, get into this talent contest. I said, no way, man. He says, get up on stage. I said, okay. And I did it, and I thought it was going to be like a joke, because I'm kind of a jackass, you know, like before jackass. I don't take anything too serious. So I said, all right, I'll get up there. He kind of dared me, you know. I'm a daredevil guy. I race motocross and all that. I'll do it, whatever. I'm definitely not scared. So I did it, and I turned it out, man. And when I got off stage, I went to the bar, and these guys were passing me cards. Hey, man, I'm with Capitol Records. I'm with all these record companies, EMI. You know, everybody mm-hmm. was in the house, and I didn't believe any of them because I'm in the hood. I mean, this is straight hood, and I'm like, you guys just printed up some business cards, and you're just trying to, you know, come up here to get the females and hang out, right? I'm not buying it. You would not be here if you were with this record company. You wouldn't be in this spot. I got one card, man, and it was Ichiban Records out of Atlanta, and I landed a small record deal with Curtis Mayfield, who was on the label mm-hmm. at the time, and I sold like 40,000 copies of Ice Ice Baby, and then it was picked up by the majors. I was only 16 when I wrote that song. So it's incredible. It was wow. 19 when it blew up. So when it blew up, it took on a life of its own. And you never know, because I don't have like a favorite song out of all my catalog. I don't say, oh, that's my favorite one. It's, you know, your fans pick you. You don't pick them.
That's so strange. That's the part. Like, how do you didn't even know this thing was going to take off the way it did.
Oh, nobody could predict what happened.
So what was it? Was there today they talk about this video went viral. That video went viral. This movie went viral. This campaign went viral. Was there a single event, a radio show, a concert, an endorsement that somebody played? Was it an LA thing? Was it a New York thing? What happened for it to go viral the way it did?
Well, it takes people to gravitate towards it. And I think the song is more than a song. And I think it became an anthem, almost to the point where it surpasses a number one hit song. And it just takes on a life of your own, becomes an anthem when people listen to the song and they remember like a photographic memory who they dated in high school, what kind of clothes they wore. Maybe they ripped out their back seat and put in subwoofers, and they can play this song and it all comes back without going through a photo album. So it reaches a level of like beyond a number one hit song.
Yeah.
Because there's been number one hit songs from here to then that you probably can't even remember. You're like, oh yeah, that Mariah Carey song, that was number one, yeah, okay. You know, but it doesn't really impact your life. I think that it impacted people's life with a movement of pop culture. And I think the pop culture and the fashion together really defines a certain generation. And so that kind of is the anthem. Ice Ice Baby and the Ninja Rap are the anthem of the 90s.
What was special about what you did is you were able to get, because at that time, you know, hip hop, typically the people who listen to hip hop, it wasn't Caucasians, you know, it wasn't like, you know.
No. Have any white audience at all. When I came out, I opened up for Ice-T, Stetsasonic, EPMD, Sir Mix-a-Lot. I was on the Stop the Violence tour.
Right.
My whole audience was always black, and that's just rap music. I thought it was always going to be that way. I didn't think it would ever change, and that's who I catered to, and that's what I did, and they accepted me, and it was the greatest thing ever, and I was fine with that. But when I say it took on a life of its own, about the time when I was the opening act for MC Hammer, and that's when everything just went. I started seeing white people come to my shows more and more, and then I seen blacks, whites, Puerto Ricans, Mexicans, and everybody in the world started coming, and I was just like, wow, this is not rap music, because I've never looked at rap music as a color. I'm not a white rapper, by the way. I'm a rapper. You know, you don't label music with colors. It's made for your ears, not your eyes. So I never compare anything or even think about that issue, and it's never been an issue with me. I reflect the music that has influenced me.
Yeah, well, what I see with what you did is it's almost when Tiger was an African-American golfer, and you're like, wait a minute, now a Middle Eastern guy like me is interested in golf. I would have never paid attention to golf. You came in, and in that time, you got people that maybe never looked at hip-hop. Because the biggest record prior to it was sold was who? Was it 500,000 records?
Yep, 500,000 records. It was like Beastie Boys, Run DMC, which was the biggest rap-selling records of all time. And then all of a sudden, my record sells 163 million.
163 million.
And it's like 25, 6 years old right now. And last year, it sold 3.3 million. My first record, To the Extreme, sold 3.3 around the world last year. It's crazy how it just keeps going and going, but you know, I don't know how to explain things, but I think that by analyzing it myself, I think that in a funny way that it's all connected to the Ninja Turtles.
You are the really Ninja Turtle guy yourself.
As funny as it sounds, I think that because the generation of the Ninja Turtles is really huge, you know, it's like our age, and then the kids today are still into it, so they can be like cool to their kids, you know, like, you like the Ninja Turtles, so did I, you know, and we have this bond. And I'm connected forever through Kevin Eastman and all the Ninja Turtles and everything. It's a culture, and it's huge, and it goes around the world. People forget that movie was big in Russia. It was big in Iran. It was big in Afghanistan.
No doubt.
And every place that you could imagine that you would never imagine, it's big there. And Ice Ice Baby also traveled through all those avenues and went through over every hurdle to get to countries that have never considered listening to rap music, not just America, because the movement started in America and it opened up all demographics, and it basically created a life of its own and became an anthem. And I'm honored, man. I mean, because it reflects the 90s, and the 90s was the last of the great decades. And the reason I say that is because of pop culture through music and fashion. If you think about it right now, they call it the lost generation, because from 2000 to 2017, there's a gap of 17 years. And they call it the lost generation because nothing defines it.
Mm.
And if you look back 100 years from now and you look at from 2000 to 2017, the only thing that defines it is computers and iPhone. iPhone came out in 2004. The laptop came out.
Interesting.
Computers. Yeah. And the computers were so big, and they still are right now, that nothing is making an impact with fashion right now. All my kids and every kid you see is wearing the same stuff from the 90s. High tops, neon colors, the same stuff we wore in the 90s. I mean, listen, we got our movies at Blockbuster, bro.
Yes, we did. 2020 on Blockbuster.
We didn't have no 1080p or Snapcrap or Instagram, right? We had flip phones. Remember? We come from flip phones, when simple life was simple, and it was just like, oh, look at this, man, my phone flips. And you had to text, like, you know,
yes,
500
Nextel
times to get, like, the number 7 to say an M or something, right? It was ridiculous.
I mean, in our time was pagers, right? Our time was
pagers came out,
and
then
the
cell
brick phones. You know, you got those big brick phones.
Right. But we come from a, you know, we used to dance. In the 90s, we danced. And the 90s was just such a great decade. It was the whole last big pop culture movement. You go in the mall today, you see everything 90s. They're coming out with the fanny pack again.
Today we're gonna be going over the latest hypebeast trend, everything there is to know about fanny packs.
They wear Wayfair glasses now. I'm like, come on, man. They can't come up with anything new, because how are you gonna wear a computer? How are you going to wear the iPhone look? It doesn't make a pop culture impact.
That's an interesting point music you're making with that.
Music makes pop culture impact, because music affects people through their memory.
Yeah.
You can play a song, no matter how old it is, and you'll remember something. When that song comes on, you'll remember who you were dating in high school,
right,
what kind of clothes or shoes you had. You'll know what kind of car you drove.
There are certain songs that make you happy instantly. I think about Will Smith, you know, Summertime. You know how that song comes in? You just kind of go in a good mood. Monel Jordan, This Is How We Do It. And then no matter when you play Ice Ice Baby, there's something that happens to you, and everybody kind of goes, it triggers something. So this happens, you go, you're selling a million records a day, it's on fire, and then all of a sudden you're getting some controversy that's coming out. You got the gig with Arsenio Hall that is going on there, and that was kind of an interesting interview the way it was done. And afterwards he says he had a bad day that day, and he got pressured because he had some misinformation, so he was upset at you,
right,
whatever was going on there. So tell me about the next part, because here you are, you're everywhere, magazine, cover of magazine, TV, news, concerts, and then boom, here comes David Bowie, Queen, you know, under pressure. How did that go about?
Well, you know, when you're pushing down walls and breaking down barriers and jumping over hurdles, and you're selling more records than anybody in the world, people are going to come at you from every angle to try to get the money, or try to cause, you know, conflict, or looking for stories to create ratings and all kinds of things. So they create all this stories and all this media hype around me because I'm the center of attention. So when you're the center of attention, and the world would rather hear, you know, more negative stuff than positive.
No doubt. That's
so
the media.
It just kind of takes on a life of its own. For me, I was young. I didn't know any different. I just rode the wave. And the way I look at it is, it's like a snow globe. It gets shaken up, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And this thing is just all over the place. I've read so many different stories about me, I don't even know what to believe. But it's amazing how you can leave such an impact that people have all these different opinions and conversations about you, you know? And
but what's the truth? What happened there with the Under Pressure song, right?
Because Under Pressure was basically a sampling. I sampled the Under Pressure song, David Bowie and Queen. And
I stole my brother's record collection because he moved out with some girl and he was all collecting dust in his closet. And I pulled out a few records, you know, and I'm like, put it on the turntable. And then a sampling machine. I had an 808, an earphone, an 808, and a Roland MPC 60. Yep, so I sampled ding, 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 ding. Right? And I'm like, oh. And then I put the beat behind it. Me and my DJ Earthquake cut it up, put it in the studio on a 16-track, not even 24-track. And this studio was made for
singing jingles. We had to convince this guy that we were going to go places and do things to give us some studio time because we couldn't afford it. We were broke. And he goes, oh, I don't know about this. It's expensive to make a record, you know, not like today where everybody's got a home studio. So we convinced him, you know. I must have busted a rhyme to him or something. I gave him a rhyme and he was just like, wow, that's pretty cool, you know, and go ahead, go in my, use my studio
this
late night,
valid.
You know, so we got to work till, you know, six every day, and after that, you can come in at night and do your thing. Boom, I put it in there, man. I made the whole record to the extreme. And yeah, I sold a million records a day. This thing came out, I went on tour, and then I went on my own world tour through America first, you know, and then when they said, you're going to Europe, you're going to London, and you're playing Wembley Arena, sold out, you know, and now we're going to Russia. And I'm started like, what? And now you're going to everywhere in the world, from to Indonesia, to China, to Asia, everywhere you could hit on the entire world. And I'm like, this is rap music. Do these people know this? Nope, but they will now. They know your song. And I go to Germany and I meet these kids who are speaking broken English, and they say, I learned to speak English on your song. What is a gauge and a nine? Some of the words with the slang they didn't understand, you know? But they rehearsed it and they learned it through the music, and I was just so fascinated by this because I never knew the impact of what I wrote down sitting in my living room right there, you know, would ever make that big of an impact. And boom. So I get samples, since my record was really blowing up, they came at me with a lawsuit, obviously, for sample clearances.
Sure.
I didn't clear any samples, you know? I just did the same thing that had been done way before I came along in rap music. But the difference
is...
Very common. I mean, I didn't invent sampling. That's a part of rap music.
Sure.
Still is today.
Still today.
They do it today. I mean, Puff Daddy gets away with it for all the heat that I took from it. What happened was is that, you know, everybody who did it before me wasn't getting sued because they didn't sell any records to get sued. So a lawyer says there's no money there. Who cares? Whether it's the Beastie Boys or Run DMC or whatever, it didn't matter. And now that I'm selling a million records a day, they're like, this is money. This is sampling. So, you know, they went after it. So they opened up an entire building in New York City called Sample Clearances. An entire building, 100 floors. And I was like, just because of me? Just because of the impact of my record. And I went through a lawsuit, and instead of, you know, going through court and everything, I settled the thing, you know? And I ended up buying the song. So I actually own a good portion of Under Pressure. So Under Pressure is my song, and Ice Ice Baby is my song.
So you own a portion of Under
Pressure.
So every time Under Pressure is in a movie, you're getting checks from
them. Yeah.
So Under Pressure was in the cartoon Sing, and it was in the movie Girl Next Door.
It don't matter.
Ice
Ice Baby, either way, I'm getting checks.
Unbelievable.
So I learned about publishing by that, you know, because Michael Jackson owns the Beatles publishing and all that. So I bought some of my publishing back and trying to put a whole catalog together. It's not easy to buy publishing, but... that's the real money. That's where it's at, you know?
So here's my question for you next, because, okay, sampling, so what? The controversy was that. Then the controversy was, you know, is this guy a real tough guy? Is he not a tough guy? Okay, no problem. I mean, they've said, did 50 get shot nine times? Did this guy get shot up? Did DMX do this? This is very common controversy that happens. But at that time when it happened to you, it seems like you were the first guy where they went to with this side of the story, right? So my questioning would be, my thought process is, how different would it have been if 1990 was 2017 with access to today's social media? Think about
it. Oh yeah, for
sure. If Vanilla Ice came out today in 2017, how many followers would you have had on Instagram? How many on Twitter? How many on, you know, Snap, and, all this stuff.
Yeah.
So would that have allowed for your career to continuously grow, or would it have been what happened to you back in the days? In 1990, 1991.
It would have been a huge impact either way, because a great song is a great song. And you could release that song today.
It would have been a huge impact.
No matter which way it's released. That song,
I wonder if it would have been even bigger.
It all starts off with the song. People can analyze it in so many ways that it becomes confusing and complicated. And it's not rocket science. It's more simple than that. The honest truth behind it is, a great song is a great song. No matter who wrote it or what it is or how it came from or anything about it. But the 90s had such a movement, you know, before social media and everything. So people really believed some of these rumors, like NWA, they really thought they were gangster. I did. I was opening up for them. And when Eazy-E came down the hallway, I stood up against the wall, go, shh, here he comes. Here he comes. Hi. I was scared of them because I really thought they were doing drive-bys and, you know, and all this stuff. But later on, we find out, you know, because, you know, I knew personally, first of all, because of the Suge Knight thing, because of all the you know, I contributed to Tupac.
Now, Suge Knight was. So huh? Suge Knight may have been a gangster guy, but
yes,
maybe not Eazy-E.
But the musicians were not so gangster like people think,
yeah.
So they called them studio gangsters, you know?
Of course.
Because if they really would advertise that on a record, they wouldn't be very smart, would they? And they'd go to prison right away. You'd be like, oh, you just told everybody you murdered people. Well, let's investigate you from the FBI. Oh, you did? Let's go to prison. So, like Bobby Shmurda, he actually said it, he wrote about it, he did it, now he's in prison. You can't do that. So the studio gangster thing came out in the 90s. You have some people who dibbed and dabbed in the streets, mm-hmm. who lived around it, so they wrote about that.
Yeah.
And that's kind of what happened. They were more like reporters of it, but when they reflected it through their music, you would think that they were the ones actually doing it. Like Ice-T was one of the originators of it, you know? And I know he's seen some gangster stuff around the streets, because we all know Compton and Watts, and we know the streets that they all grew up in, but I don't think they were the ones that were actually physically doing it. And I know all of them anyway, and I knew Tupac when he had a little high top fade, and he was really friendly, you know? And then all of a sudden he started getting more into the streets and reflecting kind of what he saw in his environment growing up. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And he became like a reporter, so to speak, to his communities and his environment and stuff that he's seen through his life. And people could read that through his music. He's a genius at it. All of them were.
So I look at it from the outsider as a fan, right? Obviously, I'm not in that world. I look at it as a fan. Tupac died in 96. I'm class of 96. So I grew up,
yep.
You know, in this side in LA. And so what I look at on your strengths is you guys are very creative. Your brain goes a million miles a minute. Like I just asked you right now, are you OCD when I looked at your garage?
Yeah.
Like this guy's a super organized guy the way you are. And you said, yes, I'm super OCD and it helps you on the real estate side.
Yep.
Is there a part of it that you think where you guys, when I say you guys, I categorize a creative community, you can adapt to new trends, which could be where you came out with your music that you had. And then your second album that you came out with was a complete shift of what your original one was. And that one didn't work out as good as the first one. You think there was a part of it where you felt like the marketplace was telling you, Ice, shift, Rob, you got to shift, you got to change and to go to this. Do you think that's what it was, or do you think it was just...
I don't care about all that stuff. I never think about outside influence. I write my music the way I write it. I've had people try to pressure me to make new records and do things, and I won't do it. It's more like a... To me, I hold it more sacred. It's more like a diary. And I'll write my diary when I feel damn good and well to write it. And I'll do it the way I want to do it. And I'll reflect it the way I want to do it. Everybody wants to come in and try to take over the wheel and steer you in this direction or this direction.
Is that how it was where you were going through and everybody was giving you?
When I started off, when it blew up, I trusted these record companies and everything. And they created these things called bios. I didn't even know what the word bio meant. I thought it was Biodome, the movie, you know? Yeah. I didn't know anything about this stuff.
Pauly Shore, Biodome.
Yeah, I didn't know. I was only a kid. So I look at it like it's a snow globe and it was all shaken up. But It was definitely such an impact that it really was confusing to me more than anybody, because I was just like, wow.
The impact of them trying to change you or trying to direct you?
They tried to change me with bios that they wrote up because they wanted to clean up my act, because now I'm catering to a younger audience.
That's what
kids.
I was saying, yeah. So
they created this image of how I look, how I dress, and, you know, try to turn me in almost to like a teen star. They did, actually. I was on all teen magazines and everything, too. Because I had such an impact of a broad-scale audience for rap music, they've never had this happen before.
Right.
So there was nobody before me. I have the first hip-hop song to ever go number one on Pop Station. First ever. And it was just uncharted territory. So what happened is that, Eminem can use my career as a guideline on what to do, what not to do, but nobody could, I didn't have anybody to look at
That's
before
right.
me. So I trusted these people just to, they're the record company. They must know what they're doing. I'm selling 1 million records a day. My bank account is huge. Go ahead. What are we doing next? I became a puppet.
That's exactly what I was asking that. So.
And I didn't want to be a puppet after I realized some of the consequences of being a puppet. I was like, wait a minute. So what happened is this snow globe kind of settled. And then I realized that it was artificial. Almost everything is artificial. In fact, all of the music industry to me, I started to get a real good focus on it. Not what the public sees, but what I see as an inside person living it.
Right.
It came in focus and it became artificial. Like, it's not a real world. Like, you think of Justin Bieber, you know, he goes around, he pees on old men off bridges, he drives Lamborghini and does drugs and whatever he does, you know, and you hear all these stories. And nobody cares about his new record at the time. They care more about, you know, TMZ and what he's doing, you know, with crazy stuff and how he basically self-destructs. So people were focusing now on how Vanilla Ice is gonna self-destruct all this huge fame and all this stuff, you know, so how's it gonna collapse? Oh my God, I'm interested now.
So talk about that. So now all that pressure's on you.
Yeah.
Everybody's preparing for you to collapse.
Yeah.
You don't have like a Eminem had a Dre, or 50 had an Eminem,
no.
or, you know, somebody has a mentor that's giving them direction. You're just kind of coming out by yourself out of
I'm
Dallas.
I'm all alone, man.
And you're making this work. What the hell are you thinking at this time? Like, how are you processing
this? I was scatterbrained, and that's what I was saying. So what happened is that I had a weekend that lasted about 3 years. and then a snow globe settled, and then I figured it out. You know what? Here's the truth. All this, the red carpets, the screaming fans, the traveling everywhere is all artificial. And then there's the real me. There's me. So the media, the fame, everything is artificial. It's not real. It's a part of my life because that's my career, my job now. But it was really just a passion. I didn't think of, I got a job, I got a career, I'm gonna make money doing this. I never did it initially to make any money or have any fame. It wasn't my purpose or my drive. My drive was to create a diary and write some songs using poetry to just basically reflect everything of my environment that I've seen in my life and grew up, you know, my life. It wasn't ever meant to be what it was, and it took on a life of its own. And when that happened, I'm the only one that's on the wave. And that wave was so big, it was like a freaking tsunami. And I'm surfing that thing, man. And I'm surfing it all the way. And as you know and I know, every wave has to hit the shore. So that wave hits the shore and crashes. And most people right there is where all the cameras come over when you hit
yep.
the shore and they go, whoa, he's self-destructing. What's he gonna do? Turn to drugs, suicide, join the 27 Club. Where are we going now? Let's see, all eyes on this. Let's throw darts at him. Let's say this and that. He's just a product on the shelf. We pull off and we'll use him for ratings, you know? Let's polish up the Suge Knight story. Oh, he hung him over a balcony now. Oh, really? Okay. You know, crazy stuff just comes out. So I learned how to differentiate that there's a real person still in here, and I had to find that real person. And I had to separate it from that artificial thing. And it was basically going back to motocross racing and hanging out with my real people. And, you know, it was one of the greatest things ever. And I learned how to, you know, and then I had a family, and I created my family and my kids. And then I realized that we are all the same around this entire world. We're all one. And once I became this super positive person, I became who I am. And I love spreading positivity because I believe this is it, man. This is all we get. We go from start to finish. Make it the best. Don't take anything too serious. Smile more through life. I don't care if it's economy, religion, your job, your family, your relationship. don't take anything too serious, including yourself. Enjoy life, guys. Man, when we die, game over. Make it a game, make it fun. Once you find a purpose that's better to live for than yourself, then you'll realize that's the meaning of life, is to have family and friends. Because I don't care what you have, how much fame you have, how much money you have, you could be driving all the Bugattis, Ferraris, everything you want. If you're alone, you'll trade it, all of it, for, you know, some green stamps and a family and friends, because the family and friends are going to treat you a lot better than your money and your fame is. And they're going to be real with you, and they're going to give you more happiness, more smiles, more love, more life than any of the rest of it. So it was a lesson that was, you know, taught to me through basically consequences of life.
So that's interesting. It's great to see where you're at right now with the project you're working on. But a couple questions while you were going through your career. Any unique Tupac stories or experiences you have that maybe people haven't heard from your point of view? Because you hear these stories with Tupac, and you hear the guy had so many multiple personalities. One minute he could be a happy guy, one minute he's talking about revolution, one minute he wants to go out there and be a player, one minute he's got a temper. Who was Tupac to you when you had an experience with him?
Well, I know Tupac. I knew him well, and he was a great guy. Very, very welcoming. He had a big heart, a big heart. And the greatest thing about him was his talent. He didn't even really know he had the talent that he had. He had a way of absorbing everything that he would see through life, whether he lived it or not. He would absorb it, and then he had the talent to bring it up somehow in a subconscious while he was in some sort of environment, a lab we call it, maybe up in the mountains, Malibu, who knows where he wrote, you know, but somewhere a Zen moment, like a writer would, you know, hibernate somewhere. Tupac had a way of taking all of the absorption and all of it and putting it into song forms, which were poetry. He was a poet. And that's, I don't even think he knew what a great poet he really was. And a lot of people can have those influences, and they just, they come in and they see things that happen through them, but they don't have a way to absorb it to where it comes out in their subconscious when they're writing. And I think he could tap into anything at any creative time, whatever he was thinking about, and write about it in a creative way, in an entertaining way. And if he was sitting there talking there, thinking about how he got here and being respectful to having money and fame, he would go into his mom and he would talk about his mom and he would write about his mother. Dear Mama. I can still get goosebumps listening to that song today.
Every time.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So he had that talent, man, that he didn't even know he had. For me, I gotta really tap into that creative juice, you know? I can't. That's why I won't just go make a record for the sake of making a record. Let's block some studio time. I'm going in to make a record. It becomes artificial at that time. For me, I want to make it a chapter of my life. I want to make it a part of something you can really look at it and say, and feel where I was at that time. You know, you tap into those emotions. And that's the greatest thing about music, is that if you can, you let your emotions out through your records, they become less artificial and more real, and people relate to it a lot more. I did a record called Hard to Swallow, and it was my therapeutical record. I did it with Ross Robinson, produced Korn, Limp Bizkit, and all these great acts. It needed to be this for me, and it wasn't because I was trying to do rock music or any kind of other thing than being orchestrated by this type of music because of what had happened in my life. Ross Robinson came to me. I didn't come to him. I didn't search this direction out, and I didn't think it would sell 10 copies, and it ended up selling 5 million copies underground with no promotion, no MTV videos, no social media, just word of mouth. Oh my God, did you hear this Vanilla Ice record? They would play it for people, and I remember hearing stories of people say, I'm going to put this CD in, and I'm going to jam this thing, and I'm going to crank it up. Now you tell me if you know who this is. And they never could guess it. And they said, I don't know who it is, but it's freaking awesome. Let's hear it again. And then they'd say, that's Vanilla Ice. And they'd be like, get the hell out of here. That is not Vanilla Ice. And it is, because of all the things that have happened in my life, you know, they were trapped in me and I needed to get those demons out. And so the orchestration of every dark thing that had ever happened in my life needed that kind of orchestration behind me.
To release
it and to make it real and fit. And that record is the most realest record I've ever wrote.
To you.
To me.
Wow.
Because it was a diary, man, and I got those demons out. And ever since I made that record, I've been happy.
Do you listen to your own music? Like, do you sit
I listen to some of my music, but some of it, like that record, I can't listen to it. I won't listen to it. I won't. Because I re-tap into some negative thoughts that have happened in my life that I don't want to relive. So I got them out. I don't want them back. You know what I mean? So if I listen to that, I will start thinking about where I was at in that time. I have a song on there called Scars. I don't want to hear it. I have a song called ADD. I don't want to hear it. It makes me depressed, and I was depressed at that time, and that's
when
why
you wrote it. You were depressed.
I was depressed.
Got it.
And I don't want to be that. I'm so happy now because I got it out of me, and that was a therapeutical record, and I never thought music could be so therapeutical. I thought music was meant to make people dance and be happy and be fun. But with my music, you know, I always took it so serious. And then, you know, with the image and the record company taking over with everything, making it cater to a younger audience and fitting kids and demographics and everything, it kind of overpowered some of the words in the music. But if you listen to all my music, I tell stories. I'm not a rapper that goes out and goes, hey, pump it up, go, go, get it, let's dance, dance, dance. And I'm really, you know, and some of those songs are good just if you want to dance and stuff. But if you listen to my music, it really does tell stories, every single one of them. You know, if you listen to Ice Ice Baby, it's a story from start to finish. Rolling in my 5.0, ragtop down so my hair can blow, shade with the gauge, vanilla with the 9, you know, 8 ball. That's cocaine, man. That's not for an 8-year-old kid. So the image overpowered it. Gauge is a 12 gauge, 9 is a 9 millimeter. I'm sitting here dancing and singing like it's the like I'm Justin Bieber all of a sudden, and so in teen magazines, and I'm going, is anybody listening to the words?
Wow.
So it took on a life of its own that even surprised me. I'm like, wow, I was never geared up to be any of this. I was never put in a position to say, let's practice before you do this, or I was just thrown out there like a piece of meat to a pack of wolves.
And let's see what comes out.
And let's see what comes out.
So you transitioned from there when I asked about Tupac and the fact that he was a storyteller, that you are also kind of a storyteller yourself. Was there a moment with Tupac that you yourself would cherish forever? Did you guys have a moment where you say, this was one moment, one conversation I had with him that I will forever remember this?
Yeah, he's got a lot of wisdom, and he gave me some wisdom. Some things that I don't feel like talking about, honestly. They're personal to me, and I'll hold them dearly forever. Great guy. He gave me some wisdom, but I also, what made him real cool to me was that he says I gave him some wisdom. You know? These are some personal things that would stir up a lot of controversy out there, so I'm gonna keep them to myself because they're personal, but that's exactly what they were meant to be, personal. It was me and him in a conversation that was brief, but very impactful to my life and the direction I decided to go and who I became. So I have a lot of influence myself, you know what I mean? And it wasn't his music that influenced me. I mean, even though he was super talented, but it was more of the people, you know? There's been other people along the way, you know?
When Tupac passed, you know, what were you thinking? Were you kind of in the mix where, because, you know, Kid Frost has his own opinions on what happened, and, you know, Cube, you know, Snoop, a lot of guys have their own opinion. Were you in the mix to kind of have some idea of what happened, or you had no idea?
Listen, nobody would ever expect Vanilla Ice to be in such of the gangster mix, but yes, I was right in the middle of it. I mean, when I saw the NWA movie, I saw the part right where I was kind of inserted. I knew them because I was their opening act,
yeah.
And I seen the whole NWA movement and everything, and then I knew when Suge Knight came in, and I knew when you see, you know that before there was Tupac, the Chronic record, and Snoop Dogg, that was the insertion of Vanilla Ice in the Suge Knight thing. Because the money that basically he took went to
finance these guys.
And by doing that, I was never bitter. I was like, wow, I just contributed to some of the greatest hip hop music ever invented, ever. The Chronic record, history, man, that's historical.
Wow.
Tupac, historical. Snoop Dogg, historical. They all knew it. All of them knew it. Everyone knew where it went and how and how it came.
It was about 3 to 4 million, right, that Suge got from you, somewhere
four,
around there?
More.
More?
Four and still going because he got points off the record. So
is he getting it or is the other guy getting it? Who's getting the points?
Yeah, he.
He is getting it, of course. You got to come back to him.
Death Row
so
Records,
what happened
man,
to Tupac, based on what you think? Do you kind of, is there a way you lean towards saying, this is the person I got Tupac? Because some say it was a Blood and Crip thing, so Crip got. Is there anything that you say who got Tupac? Do you have an idea?
I got every bit of idea, and I will not say a word, man. You're not gonna get me there, bro. You can ask me whatever you want, but I will hold that one to my grave, brother.
Well, I mean, it's been asked multiple times, and it comes back to the same guy's name, but it seems like it's a pretty.
You probably got a pretty good idea.
Okay, well,
Let me just tell you this: what you read on Google, I mean, on the internet is confusing. But I think there's been a lot of years go by, and it's always going to be like the JFK thing. It's always going to be until you have the actual person there and you've really locked it down and the case is closed.
Yeah.
It's going to be a conspiracy to the end of time.
The good thing is there was a lot of people that witnessed it, that give their own views. The cousin, you know, I think the cousin's right now making a movie about it, and he's trying to give his perspective. There's so many people close to it that can give you enough ideas to see what happened.
Let me just say this. There's a lot of people that could tell you. I doubt any of them really will. And if you find one that will, more power to you, man. Hope he's still alive the next day. I don't know. There's certain things that should stay private, you know.
And this is one. You think this is one of them? You don't think the public, the fans need to know this?
I think they can go find it pretty much online. They've got pretty good stories online.
Yeah.
Some of the avenues are artificial and not the right direction.
Got it.
But I will say this. The truth is out there online already. That's it. I'm not gonna tell you which one it is, anything. I'm not saying anything further, but it is there. It is there.
Okay, so you've had some wild experiences in your life, man. I mean, you were Barbie at one point, which is, you know, not many people can say they had a Barbie.
I laugh about it today, man. I got those dolls. I love them, man. I collect them now.
How do your kids feel about it when they say, my dad,
think I'm so cool.
That's
like,
great.
Cooler than I think I am.
That's the best thing. So you had you know, the whole Barbie doll thing, I think. You know, you were a top motocross guy that was competitive. You got a bunch of trophies on the other side there in your garage. I think in one point in 1994, you were ranked, what, number six jet skier in the world. You know, you did poetry, you dated Madonna. You had a life.
That's past tense. I have the greatest life now.
You have a happy life.
Because of what has all happened.
The experiences you had, what's the craziest experience you've had?
Oh,
a
my
person
goodness.
Like you. Give me the wildest, craziest experience.
Oh, I don't even have to blink. I can tell you right now. I had this girl that was, I guess, from a satanic church, because my birthday's on Halloween. Follow my tour around. She had a black trench coat on. She was naked underneath. She was in front of every concert, and she would flash me. And my dancers and all, we'd be like, wow, this is cool. We were just kids dancing, you know. And we didn't
Seriously.
Think much about it. And this girl, I hear this commotion on the airplane on my way to Japan. And I turn around, and they have this girl tackled on the, you know, in the jet back, you know, about three rows back. And I was just like, wow, she was screaming and trying to get to me. And I had my bodyguards, you know, at the time. I was thinking it was another crazy fan. I get off the plane, they come in, arrest her. I'm there for a week and a half in Japan, and in my hotel room, I get a knock on the door. No one's there. I open the door. There's a satanic Bible with a message written to me in the book. I pick it up, I drop it. And I'm like, wow, that's crazy. The next night, same thing, about 2 a.m., another book, another story, no one at the door. Then the third night, I just switched rooms. I told my whole, because I had the whole floor, 52 people on my payroll at the time, so I had the whole floor. And switched rooms with my road manager, John Bush. And he goes in there, and he's waiting by the door, just up all night, nodding off, but sitting by the door. The knock happens. We had some security guards at the elevator. He opens up the door and he sees this girl running down the hallway, bashing out the lights down the hallway. There's glass everywhere. And he goes, hey guys, stop that girl. And then they stop her from the elevator. So she came up the fire escape because she couldn't get up the elevator. They wouldn't let anybody on the floor. She climbed up that outside of the building, fire escape, and came in. And they trapped her in the hallway. We went out there and she was in the hallway, and she's like, crying really bad, you know, a pretty girl, and crying and just, I'm so sorry, I didn't mean to do this, I didn't mean any of this. And everybody backed up and, you can't have him, he's my destiny. And she goes, I'm so sorry, I didn't mean to do that, I don't know why I do that. And then we were all freaking out, man. We're like, what the is going on with this girl, man? Our hair was standing up on our back, and we were like, whoo, whoo, whoo. And then she would snap in and out of this character, you know, and And John Bush is over there, and he's like trying to, from the movies, I guess he saw, you know, he figured he would kind of put his hand over her head and pray, and she was trying to bite him. Arr, arr. She would say, he would say, "What are you doing here, and why are you doing this?" And, "I don't mean to do this. I'm so sorry. This is not me. I don't want to. He's my destiny. I must have him." And all these crazy things and noises were coming out of this girl. And we were just free. I was way back in the back, man. I was tripping. And she could see me through everybody and look at me when she meant this. She was from Ireland or something in Satanic
wow.
Church. And she was coming after me to, I guess, convert me because I'm born on Halloween, which is, I guess, their holiday or whatever. Who knows? But he took her down the elevator, and before they arrested her, they interrogated her. They talked to her and asked her why and what. She was a mental case, man. They're out there.
Unbelievable.
There is mental people out there. And I had nightmares for years. On the jet ski tour, I punched my buddy in the face. We were all sharing the room. We had four guys in a room, and I jumped over in the middle of my sleep with the nightmare and punched him in the face, and he punched me back. And I go, "Why'd you hit me?" He goes, "Look at you, bro." He had a bloody nose. And I was over there, and I had dragged him with the sheets off his bed, and I had thrown him up against the window, and I'm like, "I did that?" He goes, "Yeah, you crazy. You, what's going on?" I go, "Bro, I just had my first nightmare. I didn't think I could have a nightmare." And I thought this girl was coming. I had these crazy dreams, man, and I had woke up but still asleep and dragged him out and started beating my friend up thinking it was some kind of crazy girl or something.
Wow.
Yeah. We didn't know what happened. I didn't even know why he punched me, and here I am.
Oh,
and I had to stop.
Goodness.
I woke up and I looked around and I said, "I did all that." He goes, "Look at his room. You made a mess." I didn't know I could have a nightmare, and I had a nightmare like that, a living nightmare where I actually acted it out. Weird. That's
that,
the craziest thing that ever happened.
That's 26 years ago. That's like early 90s.
Yeah.
On. It's like, reminds me of the movie Exorcist, right?
I know. I don't even believe in that stuff, and yet here it is happening.
Wow.
This is from motocross.
Yeah, but this is just a few of them. This is how I became competitive, because my dad told me, he says, "Listen, you just came in fifth place." And I come in, he goes, "That's because you were at your girlfriend's house all night, and you didn't practice all during the week." He goes, "Do you want to settle for fifth place? You got more talent and more speed than the guys that just beat you. You let them beat you."
Wow.
I go, "I was trying." He goes, "I don't want to hear that. You didn't try hard enough." He goes, I said, "Wow." I went out, I told my girlfriend, "I can't come over tonight. I can't come over, can't come over." Every day after high school, or school, just regular school, I was practice, 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 practice. I get out there that weekend, every guy that beat me, I won. I started winning, he was right.
Well, he had high expectations.
Big, and he did it. He pushed me, man, into a
But from a love standpoint.
All love. I built all of this whole house, from all the ceiling applications to the fiber optic lights.
If you want to, you know, convert the room over and shut it, you'll see that everything
all
is
motorized. So even your windows turn into movie posters, your drapes, everything shuts.
Get out of it. The windows turn into movie posters.
And you're gonna love the movie posters too, by the way.
I'm assuming teenage, that's right.
You wanna see a cool toilet? We put these fancy things in, and this is already a few years old, right?
No, most people have nothing to show about a toilet, but this thing plays Bluetooth. It's got oscillating, pulsating, front cleansing. I mean, I think it's a sex toy, honestly.
Where do you keep your exotics? Where do you keep some of your cars?
I got a couple of them here. I've got other houses, all my garages.
I know you said you're building a 200 car garage, which
I collect old cars and all cars, actually.
So, Rob, how did you keep your money?
I went to work.
A lot of guys.
You know how you keep your money is you never stop working.
Good point.
You know, you don't just make a bunch of money and go, "Oh, I can retire," or "I can stop," because your bills don't stop. They always accumulate, and they get even bigger as time goes. So you just don't stop working, man. Work.
Concept.
Get up and go to work.
Some technology I found that's really cool. This could solve world hunger.
It makes water out of air. So they call it drinkable air. And this is one of the new things I'm showcasing this season on the TV show.
Drinkable air.
Yes.
Can I have a cup?
Absolutely. It's delicious.
Made out of air.
There's no water jug. There's no water feed that puts water into this. It takes humidity and makes water.
And it's cold.
It's cold, it's purified, and it's delicious. Anybody else want some? So I got hit by Hurricane Andrew. I lost a lot of these. I had tons of them, but if you look here,
the cassette tapes.
This one here is, this is how it works. This is platinum, which means 1 million records. 1 million sold. So you got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. And then you got over here, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19. There's 20 million, 25 million, 6, 7. You went 6 times platinum in Australia. There's like 30 something million. Here's another 10 million. That's 50 million.
You said 50 million so
this
far?
Is 50 I'm showing you, certified right here, but it's 163 million.
Hooked. Wow. First record?
First one.
This is the one that sold 40,000?
Ichiban Records right there.
Wow.
Yeah, that's it right there. The only painting in the world of her like that.
The only painting in the world of her like
that's
that.
That's it. Go Ninja, go, go Ninja, go.
There you go.
That's right.
That's not gonna stop.
Never gonna
that's
stop.
That's gonna continue.
Forever. Who would have thought the Ninja Turtles would continue forever? Yeah, so I love this location, and you can see it feels like we're in the country. I have all this land that I can do whatever I want with. Nobody bothered me. It's so total private. And I love it over here at the compound. Now the ocean house is cool. Got a boat and hang out there, but this is the compound. You know what I mean? Like
this,
I come over here and play.
This also kind of gives you a taste of Texas. Like
I got Texas almost there,
right? You got Texas on this side.
And I'm in the middle of Billionaire Row here. And this is gonna be a 200 car garage all right here. Air conditioned, all this.
You're saying you're gonna finish this by May?
Yes.
The whole thing.
Yeah, I just built a house on the ocean, 3 acres over here. Not one person believed it except for my crew. We work like ants on a candy bar, bro. We do not. We get after it, man.
Tell us about the Vanilla Ice project, because you've been doing some real cool stories here. I mean, people are saying, "Well, I didn't know he had this side. I didn't know he had the real estate side." And then a lot of people don't know that for 20 years, apparently, you've been doing this, you've been practicing this, you've been learning this, and now that whole noise behind us, that's a project you're working on. Apparently, right. She's saying May 1st is the timeline.
Oh, yeah, we'll get it done.
So tell us how this came about with the Vanilla Ice project.
Well, the TV show I never really wanted. I didn't even think about a TV show. I didn't pitch this. I didn't have this idea. This was Matt Levine out of New York. But the way it worked out was the TV show is I've been doing real estate for over 23 years. I worked my way up from small homes to middle-sized homes to the huge mansions you see me doing now. So just a lot of hard work, you know, getting up early and making things happen. And, you know, that's them drilling
that's
right now. They're
drilling,
cutting through
yeah.
concrete. I went to design school 18 years ago and I found a passion that I never thought you could find. I didn't even expect it or predict it. I didn't, you know, when I was doing Ice Ice Baby, I could never say, where are you going to be, you know, 20 years down the line? I never could envision this. So that even shows me to expect the unexpected. You know, and life is going to take you curves no matter how you plan it. And we all try to set goals and stuff. But if you meet someone, a relationship, that can take you off in a different direction, or a job, that can take you in a different direction. There's so many things that can
sure.
happen.
Yep.
So I expect the unexpected. So I found a passion that I never thought I would find. And I love it so much. I can't even tell you, man. And I get the same artistic fulfillment out of that as I do through music. You know, I really get to reflect. I put my signature on all my homes. I define my homes into custom homes that are different than anything else in the neighborhoods. I've made great money doing this, but it's not for the money. For me, it's art. And it's just like the music, it's art. And I create art, and I have a hard time selling them because I can become attached to them, you know? I keep half of the homes, and people are like, what are you doing with this home? Nobody's living in it. And I go, I know. What are you gonna do? Why don't you sell it? And he goes, And you think of like Van Gogh. He didn't want to sell his paintings. None of them were for sale until after he died. This is one that I built, you know, and we were having the Super Bowl party here last night, and we had this place, you know, with a lot of people here, and we were talking about, you know, all my guys have been with me for over 20 years. My concrete guys, my drywall guys, my framers.
Your
roofers.
Entire team's been with you for 20 years.
20 years.
Wow.
They're my great friends. They all come from motocross.
That says a lot about you, by the way.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah,
thank
that
you.
Says a lot about you, because if you can keep a team together for that long,
yep.
they've seen the good, the bad, the ugly
yep.
of whoever it is you're in business with.
Oh, yeah.
Very impressive.
And thank you. And that's it. I think building a strong team is essential, you know. And I do now. I do speeches and stuff like this to people who want to get into real estate or want to just build a company, even any kind of company, and how you can find success in building any kind of company. And I pride myself on, you know, what I've learned throughout the years, and I've learned a lot, you know. I know how to build a really strong team. You know, there's thinkers, relators, socializers, and directors in this world. And, you know, a socializer like myself and a director like myself can't really do the thinker and the relator thing, which is sit in a cubicle, answer and organize all the paperwork. I have to get up and get out and get in the world and walk in a room and come up with the creative ideas. But I need those people because I can't do it without them. So if I build my team and place people in the right position by basically becoming a good judge of character on what type of person they are, they're happy. Because my girl Angela, she's happy in the cubicle. I couldn't stand it. She loves organizing and doing file work and paperwork and all office work and all this stuff that I can't do. I can, but I have to force myself to do it. I don't have a thrill. She loves it, so I put her there. She loves doing that. My buddy Wes Kane, he's the guy that's always working really hard. He's my, you know, co-star on the TV show with me. He's a socializer, man. He's loud and proud, and, you know, couldn't put him in a cubicle. He's lost. So he would be as lost as if I put Angela in his position. So I know how to position people to build a successful team. And I know, you know, there's a lot of aspects there. And I learned how to do real estate on my own by reading books by Robert Sheman, by going to Borders and sitting late nights with a cup of coffee and just kind of educating myself. And
were you always like that, or did that, is it post?
Well, I didn't know how to learn anything, so I said, let me just learn it through books. And so I like coffee, I go up there, I sit down by myself, I'll pull some books off the shelf, and I'll sit down and educate myself. And so I started getting into the investment side of real estate, because I definitely love the creative side and the artistic side. So basically, I'm a builder designer. So I design the interior design as well as build the entire house.
Got it.
Most of those are two separate people. You have an architect that's going to come in and build the house, and that's just your frame. And then your walls are there and they're all blank. And then your designer comes in and puts all the candy or the jewelry or the chrome or, you know, all the cosmetics to it. I do all of that, both of them. I have a thrill for doing that. And then I started getting into, because I used to pay these designers lots of money, and I would follow them around and kind of intern. And I said, oh, so that's how you do it. And then I started looking at dollars and cents, and I said, you know what? I'm paying you guys a lot of money. And yes, I'm making a profit, but I could make a bigger profit if I excluded you guys and did what you're doing myself. Now, everybody thinks they can become a designer if they have money, but you can't. Let me tell you right now, I thought I could until I went to design school, and then I learned that, oh my gosh, everybody thinks they're a designer, but they're not. You know what I mean?
So it's gotta be kind of part of your
DNA.
It's a
difficult thing. You have to learn about different themes and different, you know, from transitional to contemporary.
I feel even if you do, you gotta have an eye for it. So
you have to have a passion and an eye and a talent for it. But you have to also understand that, you know, color palettes are a big, big way to cater to demographics if you're selling a home.
Interesting.
And you got to do your research on what kind of people are in the area and what kind of income bracket they are, what kind of nucleus you live around, from restaurants to, you know, schools, and what kind of family is going to be buying your home, what age brackets and income. So you got to think of all this and who you're catering to. You don't want to make your home for you if you're trying to sell it. You want to make it cater to them. So you learn about earth tone colors, throw pillows, fireplaces, staging the properties, visuals, focal points, all kinds of great things that you would see as a buyer, because you only get one time to make a first impression. So I started getting into the investment side of this and started looking at the dollars and how I can build these teams and how I can really make more profit. So I own a mortgage company now, because I learned how to make money through the mortgage points, and I learned how
based out of
Miami. Open in 49 states.
Got it.
And I have a small but efficient real estate company, brokerage, everything. So we do it in-house, and all my people, I take them on trips, and I buy them lunch every day.
Solid.
My people love me, and I love them.
And how long has this been?
23 years of building this whole thing up to where it is now.
Wow.
And my TV show has been running 8 years of the Vanilla Ice Project. So it's not just here's a rapper one day and here he is doing homes. This has been a long time.
Good for you, man.
And And I love it, you know? So there's so many different ways to make money and happiness and fun and art and creativity that I just love it. And it's you gotta be built for it. It is tough. But, you know, I lose a lot of sleep thinking about what I'm gonna do next, you know? I go to Europe to go to like builder shows so that I purposely, stuff that I introduce on my homes is not something you're gonna see on any other TV show, whether it's a construction or a design show. You're not gonna see it because I'm going through the far reaches of the universe. I go to Latvia, Estonia, to builder shows, to stuff that you're not gonna get on aisle 10 in the local hardware stores here. You're not gonna find it. And then people are always like, wow, where did he get that idea? Where did he come up with this? International builder shows, I find them everywhere. I lose sleep thinking about it and I'm just loving to showcase it on my show. So my show's not a flip show. It's a pretty much a design show, really. The latest and greatest in home technology and home design. And even my show has taken on a life of its own. If you watch season one to season eight, it's evolved. And it just gets bigger and better every season. And as you can see, I can talk about this forever because this is my passion.
Yeah, I can tell you're excited about it.
So, you know, the old school and Tupac and all that, that's 20 something odd years ago. And it's cool and I can talk about it. But I think more people are interested now with what I'm doing lately and what I'm doing with the real estate, because I have a lot of top designers and stuff that look at how I do things and stuff, and they're my mentors. And I look up to them and they're following some of my trends. I'm starting to see a lot of my trends in certain design features, you know, and it's amazing that I get a chance to showcase this to the world. And we have over 100 million viewers watching this show. So I'm honored that so many people gravitate towards it. And I think that my show, by what I hear everywhere and everybody talking, has inspired people to put more money in their house, and because they get it out in happiness. Your home is your sanctuary. Your home is where you, like, even after a great vacation, you just go, I can't wait to get home. After your long day at work, where do you want to go? I want to go home. I just want to go home.
You sure you're not an entrepreneur at heart, instead of just because? Because if you would have never done any music and I didn't know you and you just got into business, you sound like a CEO of a real estate company. You sound like a guy running a big business.
You know, I am, and I've become that.
It's
amazing.
It's trying to put that identity behind to see who is Rob versus, you know, obviously that identity also helps as well. But you sound like you're selling like a pro. You're communicating like a pro.
I love what I do, man. You give me a cup of coffee, I'll talk your ear off.
It's oozing out of you. So, brother, where can everybody see the show? For some people that don't, I know there's 100 million people that do, but those who don't, where can they find your show?
The show is on DIY Network. It's a DIY channel, pretty much. It's an upgrade package, so if you don't get it on your regular basic cable, it's $12 extra a month. Get the upgrade package, you'll get the DIY Network, which it'll blow you away. It's part of Scripps Network, so it's owned by the same companies as HGTV, DIY Network, Cooking Channel, Travel Channel. All these are the same big corporation called Scripps Network. So get the upgrade package. You can get all these channels, and it's an amazing thing to show people how to do it yourself at home.
Where should people follow you that links always back to the show? Is that Instagram you push, or are you more a Twitter guy?
I do them all, man. I do Instagram, Twitter, Facebook. So I'm all over. I got my own website, Vanilla Ice. It's really simple. I mean, we call it simple as a pimple. At Vanilla Ice. So you can't get
That's
any more
it.
Simple than that.
So we're gonna put all the links on the bottom to go visit the project that he's working on. Rob, AKA Vanilla Ice, brother,
My
thank
man.
You for your time. Really
oh,
enjoyed
anytime,
it together
brother.
At your place, man.
My pleasure,
this was
welcome.
Cool.
Yeah.